friends, on behalf of the Hotel and Restaurant Association Western India and Sheila Raja College, it gives me immense pleasure in welcoming all of you to this very important and educative seminar. We have on the dais two very distinguished speakers who have the expertise and the knowledge on two very interesting topics. Is molecular cuisine, mixology, a new phenomenon, and Indian molecular cuisine? I now wish to invite Mr. Shail Bharat, our young and dynamic chairman of the seminar subcommittee, to deliver his welcome address. Mr. Bharat.
Thank you, Mr. Shatbi. Very good afternoon to all our delegates, students and faculty who've joined us today for the seminar. Before I introduce the speakers for today, I'd just like to share an event that we're going to be hosting in the Western region. That's the 51st FHRAI Annual Convention in Indore in the month of September. And the details for the same you can find on our Facebook page. You can give us a call at the HRAWI office. And in case any of you are not receiving our newsletter that comes out every month, please get in touch with the admin staff. They'll take down your details and make sure that you get that newsletter every month. A thank you to Principal Sami for organizing this and Mr. Ashti for getting in touch with our speakers and getting them organized for today. We have a great lineup of speakers this afternoon, and I can certainly say by the end of it, we all have we'll gather a lot of information from their experiences. We'll be starting with our seminar with a presentation by Mrs. Shatbi Basu. She's an alumni of IHM Mumbai, and she's passed out in the year 1980. She began her career working at various independent F&B units. And she's established the first ever platform for bartenders in India. That's the STIR, the official meet for bartenders, a seminar cum competition for professionals, students, and amateur bartenders. Surprisingly, she started these classes at Revival at Chopati. So I remember I was about 6 or 7 years old, and Dad used to tell me to just go and check out what exactly she's doing. I used to peep through the door, and I used to see that there was this lady who's mixing two or three different colored cocktails, and there were so many people who were interested in looking at what she's doing, and I had no idea. I'm like, why is everyone so interested? And it's been 19 years since then, and I yet don't understand the magic you do in drinks. But anyway, getting on with her profile. She's been appointed the American Whiskey Ambassador of India. She's currently a consultant to a huge number of organizations. And the project she's completed is running into almost 3 or 4 pages. So I don't think, I don't have the time to get into each and every one. But I'll just go ahead and introduce our next speaker now. Chef Gautam Maharishi, he's began his career with the Taj Mahal Mumbai in 1995 as an MT. And a decade later, he stepped into the position of corporate executive chef at the Sun Sand. And after a stint at the Claridge's Hotel, New Delhi, where he was instrumental in the rebranding and repositioning of various restaurants at the hotel. Currently having numerous shows on India's first food channel, Living Foods by Z Entertainment. Chef on Wheels, Bake Do Teen, Food Ka Mood, Jain Jalsa, How Se Wow Tak, and the list is endless. So that's the two speakers that we have for this afternoon, and I'll request Mr. B.P. Sani to felicitate them and just say a few words.
That's what. he's focusing in the camera.
The esteemed speakers of the day is Shatbi Basu and Chef Gautam Maharishi, the chairman of the Sangraha Committee, Shane Barrows, Mr. Aspi Nalathet, who is the Secretary General of the FHRA, the HRA Western India, esteemed members of the Hotel and Restaurant Association, principals, teachers and students from various colleges. Let me extend a very warm welcome to all of you to the Sheena Reja Institute of Hotel Management. In association with the Hotel and Restaurant Association, we are one of the youngest members in the association. As an educational institution, we are just 3 years old. We started the 3 years, 3 years back and completed the first batch in the year 2015-16. We started with the 3 year degree BSc Hospitality Studies affiliated to the University of Mumbai. Our college, we had worked on 4 new programs, starting with culinary arts and one in the hospitality studies and master's degree. All these programs are approved by the University of Mumbai and still waiting for the approval from the government of Maharashtra. I hope and I pray that our students will get a chance to do this program this year. I would like to talk much because the 2 speakers are here and we are running short of time. So thank you very much for all of you coming for this program. Okay.
Maybe invite Ms. Shatbi Basu, take the center stage.
Years ago, when suddenly is there someone who's controlling this? Can we go down just a little bit? Just a little bit. I think it's kind of. Then we should be good. Is this better?
Yeah.
Okay. You guys can hear me out there, right? Is it all good?
Yes.
Right then? Are we all good? All right. So about 5, 6, 8 years ago, I had a call from a journalist. She called me to say, so what do you think of this new? Now, that question kind of knocked me out of it, because as far as I was concerned, mixology was always molecular, because I had studied chemistry. At that point of time, I had no idea why I had studied it. I didn't know if I'd ever use it ever in my life. And because of that, I knew that alcohol is a molecule. I also knew that everything I mixed was another molecule. I also knew that whatever step I stirred, I was taking various molecules and putting them together and turning them into a solution. If there were some that were unmixable, I would put them on ice and I would shake them, turn them into a suspension. It was still physics, it was still chemistry, it was still molecular. So the question was, what the hell is everyone doing? That is not what I'm doing. So I, of course, relied on Google. And so what is it that the whole world is doing that I'm not? And I looked, and I searched, and I smiled, and I said, I'm doing a damn bloody good job. And I stopped at that. thought to myself, is this the route I want to take? I've always been a bit of a rebel. Forever, for as long as I can remember. My mother will vouch for it. I hate doing what other people do. When everyone had straight hair, my hair was curly. When everybody had curly hair, my hair was short and straight. My sister thinks I have an abominable sense of fashion because I don't care what I wear. And when it came to mixing drinks, I'm probably just the same. I said to myself, and I asked myself this question, when people come to a bar, do they come because they are hungry or do they come because they're thirsty? The answer I got was thirsty. If they were hungry, they would probably go to a restaurant and then order a drink, because what was on their mind was food. But if they come to a bar, what is on their mind is the drink, and they're happy to eat as well. But foremost on the mind is the drink. And I thought, if all of these people are turning my liquids into solids, why would anybody who's thirsty, who really needs to quench his parched throat, want to have something solid instead of something liquid? And that's where I began. But over the years, I've been watching other people do it. I've been admiring it all. Because when you don't do something, you admire what other people do. And, you know, I've been saying, good job. And every time somebody asks me something like that, I call them and say, hey, this is your... You don't need to write off everything that you don't like or you're not comfortable with it. You can look at it. You can understand it. You can then decide whether there was a way in which you could use some of that knowledge in the way that it suited you and your ideology. Is that even possible? Of course it is. No knowledge is wasted. No knowledge is bad. I just don't like cut and paste. And I don't like to do what everybody else does, like I said. And I think blindly aping the West, it's not the best thing to do. I think each one has something to offer, and if we pick and choose what can be turned into great ideas, then both have enough and more to learn from each other. And so the route I took was, I know that my customers are thirsty. I don't know about other people's customers, but mine come thirsty, because they come to the bar and the first thing they tell me is, man, make me something really cool to drink. Drink, not eat. Drink. The other objection I have very often is that already the government taxes us enough. Already alcohol costs really, really high. The kind of taxes they load onto a bottle is really disgusting. So if I can buy a bottle of, say, a Johnnie Walker Black Label or a Jim Beam White in Gurgaon, I can buy it for $2,500 a bottle. I can buy a bottle of Jim Beam White at $1,100 a bottle. And for the same bottle here, I'm paying all that extra money, and all that is only tax. Because that means that it can be sold everywhere for, say, between $2,500 and $3,000. Yet, we're paying $5,000 and $5,500 for a bottle. To that, if I were to import stuff to make my drink solid, I'm adding more cost, which they don't need. And what cost will I sell it to them? And how many times will they come back to me to drink it over and over again? Or they might drink it one off to say, hey, let's have fun. But will they come to my bar every day and say, that's what I want to drink? And so, I chose the other route, to say, study it, understand it, and then see how you can apply it and make it interesting. For me, molecular starts with the alcohol and then goes by what people want today. I've realized, and I've been doing this for about 35 years, that I've realized that everyone's palate changes every 5-6 years. New people come in, young people come in, their palates change, the way they look at things, the way they want to drink, their flavors, everything changes. And if you can apply that to what you do and give everyone a little bit of what they want and yet create something that is incredibly tasty, because at the end of it, whatever you do to the drink or to the food, if it doesn't taste good, then whatever you've done is a waste of time. Because everything can't be about presentation. If the presentation is brilliant, the drink should be even more brilliant. Because when you put something in your mouth, if it doesn't sing and do a little dance in your mouth, nothing is worth it. And that's where I am. So what I'm going to show you is that you don't have to be only worried about presentation. You don't have to add your costs. You can do things without adding too much to your cost. But at the same time, you can play with flavors and add all kinds of things to enhance the flavors and play with it in a way that makes the experience for your customers really fabulous. So the two things that I work with very often are smoke and an incredibly great use of the cream canister. And when I started it, the first time I was really afraid. So I just stood there and I gave it to them and I said, listen, okay, all this ridiculous stuff, I'll tell you what I want. I'll figure it out in my mind. You guys put it together, put the charges, do whatever the hell you want, but I'll tell you what I want at the end, make sure it happens. So I give them a recipe and I say, this is the flavor that I want. And they put, God knows what, they put that thing and they shake it and charge it and do all kinds of stuff, put it in the fridge, and then it comes back to me and I kind of make my drink and I stand aside and I said, now do it. And then they hang the foam on top and suddenly that damn drink is looking brilliant. You know, oh my God, this is so cool. And it's not just looking brilliant, but more importantly, when you taste it, the liquid hasn't gone anywhere. See, that's the beauty of it. It's all liquid in one form or another. So there's the serious alcohol at the bottom, which has got all the liquid that you want. And then the stuff on top is kind of semi-liquid. So it's creamy, but you're sipping through it. So you've got the liquid in your mouth. The flavor explosions are changing. So your experience is still drink. Your experience is still about what you expect from me, great flavor. And then on top of that, you're getting this, oh my God, this is like, wow. That's what makes the whole experience a little different. So today I'm going to show you a few things that use what other people call molecular. I think it's just being creative in what you do and using what the kitchen and the coffee shops have used all along. And do it in another way. So the first thing that I want to show you is I'm going to make the drink and he's going to do the molecular stuff. All right? Because I'm still not comfortable with it. Okay? I still don't like using my hands there. I only use this. And I know that sooner or later I'm going to have to use my hands. But see what I mean? I like to do that, but I like to make noise with it. What are we doing first? The whiskey? Okay. Now there's two kinds of things. And by the way, feel free to ask me questions while we're doing all these things, okay? So, where's my friend? I need the ice now. Thank you. So everyone's heard about this classic cocktail called the whiskey sour, right? Everyone knows it? Every college has studied it? Have you done it? Second year, guys?
Yes, we have. Yeah.
You do, right? Okay. So did I. Nothing changes. How can anything be contaminated if it's a good egg and it's inside? But yet, people are afraid. So we've done away with egg white in so many of our cocktails because of this whole thing. And I've decided, you know what, I'm going to bring it back and I'm going to write against that cocktail that contains egg and then let it out there. And the weird part is all those people who say, I don't want egg, suddenly will come and say, whenever there's a new fad, and the latest one right now is pisco sour, which is a very classic drink from Peru and Chile. And nobody even asks you if there's egg in it. And they're drinking it. Because they all only know one thing, oh, the cool thing now is to drink pisco sours. But the damn pisco sour has egg, and no one has yet questioned, what is this thing that you're putting on top why is it looking all foamy and all that? And they're drinking it. I don't know how many of them are vegetarians. I don't know, because they're not even asking us about it. I, of course, now put it on the menu with my little dot which says contains an egg. So we've taken the whiskey sour and we've twisted it a little bit to say, you like the whiskey, right? A lot of people say, oh, you make cocktails with whiskey and you lose the whiskey. So I'm saying, let's not lose the whiskey. Drink the whiskey, drink my flavor as well. But what I did is, I put all the flavor into the foam on top. Inside, it's pure, unadulterated whiskey. So, simply, rocks glass. In goes the whiskey. Seriously? Hello? We're still doing this, no? I'm losing it. All right, so here's the whiskey. Oh, so good. So good. So, here we have two glasses with rocks, and we have the whiskey there. And what I need you to do is to give me the foam, and you're going to put the whiskey foam, the whiskey sour foam. I don't know which one of them has it. And I want you to just put it on top. Now this looks like I'm piping a cake. Yes. And then all I'm going to do is just put this on top like this. And it's as simple as it can be. There is no fuss, no panic, no nothing. The max, if you like bitters, and these days, courtesy of FSSAI, has no bitters as well. I like to put a few drops of Angostura bitters. So now we're experimenting with trying to create our own little bitters. So, oh God, I didn't do a thing. What happened? So, molecular can be really simple as well. Doesn't have to be complicated at all. Yet, at the same time, it's adding a little pizzazz to the way in which you're interpreting a drink. Simplicity, for me, is the best way forward. And you know, I haven't seen Sangram in a really long time. He's one of the only few bartenders that go back as old as me, but he's still younger than me. Still, I'd like you to taste this for me and tell me whether it works for you and Chef.
It always does.
Aapko banate rahoge?
I'm not an alcoholic, so it's okay.
Drink at all? No,
I still taste it.
Taste it. I don't want you to drink it, see? I'm a firm believer in not drinking, but only tasting.
So how do I go to the bottom level?
You kind of tint the glass and you let the whiskey come through to you. Yeah, it'll come through. You don't have to tint it. It's there.
It did come through. Yeah. The spark is that it's holding.
Exactly.
Yes, that's what doesn't happen when you have a stir cocktail.
Correct.
It becomes like a mess.
And it just kind of, you know, comes apart.
And
it's nice and creamy.
Yes, it is. And if you feel like sharing with somebody, it's always looking good.
Yeah.
Even 3-4 people can share.
There you go. Is that good? So, what we're saying is that you can play with it and you can pass it around for anyone who wants to taste it. Go at the back. Is there anyone who wants to taste it? Please. This is way too radiant. Don't even think that it's coming to you guys, okay? There's no way, okay? Fantasize about it. No way it's happening. No way it's happening. All right. The next one. The next one is a twist on another classic drink called the old fashioned. So we have the old fashioned, and the old fashioned is a drink that we learn again very, very often. In college, we have a recipe which says start with an old-fashioned glass, take a cube of sugar, soak it in a nostril bitters, then put one spoon of water, muddle it till it begins to melt, then fill the glass with ice, put in the bourbon. In India, everything has been about scotch. But I'm going back to the roots of these cocktails, and they say bourbon, so that's where we're going. And then you put in the bourbon, and you stir it, and then you either put a maraschino cherry, which is so difficult, or you just take a twist of orange and put it in, which is so much easier. And that's the way to go. So today what we've done is I've twisted it a little bit, and what I'm doing is instead of using sugar, I'm using apricot to flavor the old fashioned. So I'm not doing a classic old fashioned, I'm taking the old fashioned, yet I'm going to, instead of sugar as a sweetener, I'm using apricot jam. Now, I play with the apricot jam in many ways. Sometimes we make our own little apricot jam by taking Indian apricots as opposed to the tangy orange fellows which come from Iran and other such places and soak them in the bourbon. And then use the flavored bourbon and then take the apricots and turn them into a jam. And then you can use them in the kitchen as well. Because that apricot jam with your barbecues is mad, completely and totally mad. So we're going to take this old fashioned, and what we want to do to it to make it different is we're going to smoke it and let the smoke envelope the old fashioned and then pour it out in front of the guest, and he's sitting there and he's still going to drink that beautiful thing, but he sees that smoke coming out, which is the real smoke, as opposed to people who put it in double containers and put dry ice and a splash of water and then blah 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 blah, all kinds of smoke coming out, but there's no flavor, no nothing. I've seen one guy even clapping, taking so much pain to take basil leaves and clapping it, putting it in, and then letting it go into the drink from the top. And I'm saying, it's dry ice, for Christ's sake. How the hell is the basil coming through in the dry ice? But people who don't know, obviously, they're all excited to see that. And I'm like, really? Where is it? I'm getting nothing, because there's no smell there. It's just dhuan. But here is real dhuan. Now, I have to tell you that before the smoking machine came, and again, I don't like these little things, they misbehave just when you want them to work. They just stop for some weird reason. Right in the middle of everything, they just stop working. And then 2 seconds later, someone else comes along and says, oh, and it's working again. So it happened to me at one time. And since I wasn't very savvy with all these kind of equipment, I thought, now what the hell am I going to do? I have to make my smoke drink. And I said to myself, why the hell am I relying on this nonsense? I went to the kitchen and told that tandoor guy, Baba, ye isme mere ko laal wala koila de do. Because I have endlessly used coal. Cheryl, you'll know, because your dad introduced me to the smoked chas, which is fabulous. And I used coal for a lot of stuff in my own kitchen. And I thought, why am I even wasting my time on this? I didn't even try and make it work. I just got koila from the kitchen and I told him, just keep chota wala endless supply for me. Whenever I want, I'll tell you, ek bowl mein laake de do. I just put it, I put my spices on it, I put a little bit of cream because I didn't want ghee and butter ka dhua. So I put a little cream, just enough liquid to kind of get it smoke. Put my glass over it like that and I waited and then covered it and did that. Man, that smoke was so much better than this smoke. So much better. So I have to now find a new way of creating a machine like this using koila smoke and then doing that because it just gives way more. And that is what I mean by saying we can teach those guys. Why are we letting them teach us all the time? He's the chef, right? I can see a few chefs there as well, right? You know what you have to do, right? That's our tradition, isn't it? Dua, dungar, dump, it's our tradition. Why are we not doing molecular and using that smoke to create this mad flavor? Because I have to tell you, that cocktail with that dhua tasted way, way, way better than this. This, of course, is easier. But it looked, it tasted way better because that flavor was just absolutely brilliant. So that's what we're going to do. Okay, I'm going to let you do this one. How about that? You go ahead. So you want me, okay, you want me to make it first. All right. And then you do the rest, okay? So